This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book, For the Good of the Team. Author, Ralph Henry Barbour. Year, 1923. Chapter 1, A Hero Returns. Two boys met in the Grand Central Station in New York one warm afternoon in late September, and greeting each other, passed hurriedly toward the gate beyond which the Hartford Express waited. Each was good-looking, well-built, alert, and self-possessed. But a few months separated their ages, although Jack Brewton had seen his 18th birthday and Stuart Harven had not. In the train, their bags at their feet, they plunged into conversation. While they had been close friends at Manning School, they had not met during vacation, nor had they corresponded. At 17 and 18, one is far too busy for letter writing, and fortunately, friendship doesn't demand it. There was, consequently, much to be said, and the journey to Safford was half over before the subject of summer adventures had been exhausted. Then Stuart gave the talk a new turn, with the careless announcement. "I had a letter from the new coach about a month ago." "Haynes?" asked Jack interestedly. "What did he have to say?" "Oh, nothing much. Said he thought he ought to get in touch with me, and hoped I was having a pleasant vacation and all that. Suggested my meeting him in New York and talking things over, but I couldn't make it. The date he set was just the time we were starting off on the cruise."
"Too bad," murmured Jack.
"Oh, I don't know. What's the good of talk? There wasn't anything to be done until we got the team together. I hope to goodness he isn't going to be one of the talky kind. His letter looked that way. He wrote about 4 pages, I guess. Said he hoped I was keeping in good condition and wasn't neglecting kicking." Stuart chuckled. "I haven't touched a football but once since spring practice. Then, we had a sort of a game up at the camp one day. A lot of the college chaps were football men, Means of Cornell and Davis of Dartmouth and 5 or 6 others. We had quite a scrappy little game. Played 2 20-minute periods. Of course the counselors won, but they had to work for it. I played quarter and got off 2 dandy runs, one for nearly 70 yards.
"You ought to have put in some practice just the same, Stuart," said Jack disapprovingly.
"It wouldn't have done any harm."
"Did you?"
"Yes, I've been at it pretty steadily for the last month."
"Faithful old Fido," laughed Stuart.
"Well, I don't believe in it. A fellow comes back much fitter and more ready for work if he doesn't wear himself out during the summer. I don't think it hurts you any, for you're a shark for work and always were, but I get stale if I overdo it. Bet you I'll show more pep tomorrow than the fellows who have been summer training."
"Maybe," answered Jack, smiling but unconvinced. "Still, pep isn't everything. I'll bet you can't kick 5 goals out of 10 tries from the 30-yard line tomorrow."
"What of it?" laughed Stuart. "I'll be able to next week.
Look here, what's the good of bringing the team back 5 days before term opens if they're going to know it all before they come? That's what the early session's for, to get us back in shape."
"We ought to be in shape when we get back," answered Jack. "We can't afford to give Pearsall even 1 day's start of us, Stuart."
"Don't you worry about Pearsall this year," replied the other, smiling and confident. "We're going to do her up, Brown."
"Hope so."
"Sure to. At least, we will if Haynes turns out all right. I'm still wishing, though, we'd gone after Corcoran."
"What's the use of wishing it?" asked Jack with a shrug. "You know we couldn't have paid his price. Take my advice, old son. Forget Corcoran and make the best of Hop Haynes. Anyhow, Stuart, don't start out with a prejudice toward him."
"Oh, I've got nothing against the man. I dare say he will do well enough.
Still, you know yourself, Jack, he's just a small-town coach, never did anything big."
"If he had, Manning wouldn't have got him," replied Jack.
"He put in 3 successful years at Fisherville, though, and was assistant at Erskine a year before that. Fisherville doesn't play a team unless she knows she can beat it. Anyone could coach Fisherville to win. Bet you I could myself."
Jack smiled and shook his head. "You're a great little quarterback, Stuart, and you're the youngest Captain Manning has ever had, and all that, but don't ever try coaching old son. You couldn't do it. How do you make that out? Demanded Stuart. You don't have to be a wonder to coach a football team. No, but you have to have one quality that you haven't, Stuart, answered the other in good-humored raillery. What's that? Asked Stuart suspiciously. Amenability, replied Jack gravely. What's amenability? You mean good nature? Rot. Look it up when you get a chance, laughed Jack. Anyhow, you stick to captaining. I believe I've been insulted, but no matter. Say, I ran across a couple of nice-looking plays this summer. They're not new, of course, but we've never used them and they might be good medicine for Pearsall. Got a piece of paper? An old letter will do. That's the ticket. Stuart produced a pencil, and the two boys leaned their heads close while it traced strange lines on the back of an envelope. Half an hour later, the friends parted, Stuart carrying his bag to Lacey Hall and Jack taking his to Meg's. They were to meet later for supper in the village. Meals for the football candidates were to begin with breakfast in Lyceum House tomorrow, and meanwhile there were trunks to be unpacked. Stuart's room, on the second floor of Lacey, had been prepared for his occupancy. One of the two small beds was made up, and the accumulated dust of the summer had been removed. Stuart set his bag on the table and looked about him. The room with its gray-papered walls, its brown craftsman furniture, its two-tone blue rug and its pictures and trophies was surprisingly like home, and he gave a sigh of satisfaction as he threw aside his coat and went to the end window. The sun had traveled past, and when he raised the shade and the lower sash, a cool breeze entered, bringing with it a few dried ivy leaves from the stone sill. Below him lay a narrow strip of grass between the building and school lane. The young maples that lined both sides of the way, the lane had been cut through but 4 years ago, were still green, but the leaves looked dry and tired, as though the hot summer had been almost too much for them. Across the graveled thoroughfare, seen from the window between the upper branches of the trees, was Memorial Building, the dining hall, its buff sandstone front with its four tall columns hot in the afternoon sunlight. Further to Stuart's left stood the library, beyond it the tennis courts. Straight ahead, the school grounds ended at an iron fence half hidden by shrubbery and vines, and then came an open field that descended to the placid, winding river. The new steel bridge, over which High Street led, was just visible past the corner of Memorial. Beyond it, nestling neath tall elms, spread the town. Two church spires, one slenderly conical and one square and dignifiedly squatty, pierced the greenery with their white forms, and now and then a weathered gray roof or a red-brown chimney peeked forth. Safford was like half a hundred other Connecticut towns, quiet, as placid as the river that flowed around it, and unvexed by the problems that beset larger communities. Twice a day the express paused for a moment at the little station, and at four other times local trains tarried on their way up and down the valley. There were no streetcars, and speaking comparatively, even automobiles were scarce. Safford's only claim to renown was Manning School, and there had been occasions, perhaps there still are, when Safford's inhabitants would have been willing to worry along without such fame. The celebrations of athletic victories occur only infrequently, however, and for the most part the townsfolk had no cause for complaint, and were doubtless glad enough of the presence of the big school across the river. I know the storekeepers were, anyway. Stuart's trunk arrived before he had quite finished washing off the dust of travel, and for nearly an hour after that, he busied himself unpacking, stowing his things methodically away in drawers or hanging them neatly in the closet, in the latter process, carefully taking up no more than his half of the hooks. The occupant of the other bed and proprietor of the second chiffonier would be along in a few days, and there must be space for his belongings. Neil Orr came from Stuart's home city, and represented the reason why Stuart was remaining in Lacey through his upper middle year instead of moving to Meigs, as was the privilege, almost invariably taken advantage of the third-year students. Neil was a lower-middle-class fellow, and since he must remain in Lacey, Stuart had elected to remain with him. To his own belief, at least, Stuart had acted as guide and protector to Neil during the previous year, and he couldn't conceive of Neil's getting along without him. Perhaps he exaggerated his usefulness to Neil somewhat, but the motives that prompted him to forego life in the upper-class dormitory were wholly creditable. It was still too early for supper when he had finished his task and changed into a comfortable old suit, and probably because Neil was still in his thoughts, he went down and crossed the old campus to Holton Hall. The northern half of the school property had become known as the old campus when School Lane had been cut through. It held 5 dormitories and Manning Hall, the latter accommodating the recitation rooms, the assembly hall, and the offices. Of the 5 dormitories, Holton was the elder brother and stood back from the rest as though keeping a fraternal watch on them. Stuart was not sure that his visit would prove successful, for there still remained 4 days before the faculty members were required to report, but when he came within sight of the corner study which was his destination, his doubts were removed. The 2 end windows on the lower floor were wide open, and the brown silk sash curtains were pushed wide. Mr. Moffat, attired principally in a pair of discolored gray flannel trousers and a running shirt, was applying a piece of emery cloth to the head of a lofter when Stuart, accepting the invitation to enter, pushed the study door wide. A golf bag leaned against the Morris chair at the instructor's elbow, but it went to the floor with a rattle and crash of its contents when Mr. Moffat jumped up. "Hello, Harven," he exclaimed in pleased surprise. "So we're back again. My, my, and all browned up like a berry. Well, I am glad to see you, my boy." He shook hands with a grip that made the visitor wince, and pushed the latter toward a chair. "You've found me in rather an undignified moment, it seems. Suppose you take your own coat off and lend me countenance. It's been frightfully hot here today."
"Hot everywhere, sir.
New York was like an oven."
"You came that way.
Isn't there a shorter route from Springfield?"
"Yes, but you have to change, sir.
And I wired Jack Brewton to meet me at the Grand Central."
"Been playing golf, sir?"
"Yes, quite a lot this summer.
But it's over with."
Mr. Moffat sighed. "Harven, I'm more than ever convinced that the destiny that shapes our ends made a botch of it in my case. I ought to have been born with a silver spoon. I'm naturally the laziest man on earth, except as to one thing. That's golf. I'll toil from sunup to pitch dark playing golf, but anything else, especially the teaching of English, comes mighty hard. And this fall, it seems to me that I'm lazier than ever before. I don't want to go back into harness one earthly bit, my boy. I sigh for wealth and slothfulness, for silken shirts and shaded porches. The gods bestow their favors blunderingly."
"You'd soon get tired of silk shirts and porches," laughed Stuart.
"I'm sure I would.
Want some help with those, sir?"
"Thanks, but this is the last. I'm putting them to bed for a 9-month sleep."
"Unless," the instructor's eyes brightened, "you play?
There's a very fair links over at Harrington, and I could sneak in a couple of hours in the morning."
"I don't, sir.
Besides, football begins tomorrow, and I suppose we'll have 2 sessions a day until Wednesday."
"That's why you're back."
"I'd forgotten." Mr. Moffat slipped the lofter into the bag with a sigh. "That reminds me that I met your new coach this forenoon. He seems a very pleasant, affable sort, but he doesn't play golf.
Have you met him yet?"
"No, sir."
"Do you know where he's staying?"
"He told me, but I've forgotten. I'm afraid I lost interest when I found he was not a golfer. Somewhere in the village, of course. I thought of looking him up this evening, but if I don't know where he's living, I suppose I can't do it.
He's probably taking his meals at the hotel.
I fancy you'd get a word of him there, Harven."
"Yes, sir, but there's no hurry.
I'll see him in the morning."
"Are there many of the team back, do you know?"
"I don't.
You're the first chap I've seen.
No one's come yet, except Mr. Wallace and me, so far as I know. Dr. Gurley's back, of course. I took dinner with him last evening. Vacation appears to have toned him up remarkably."
"So it has you, my boy.
Have a pleasant summer."
"Dandy, sir.
You're looking awfully fit, too.
I suppose so. Yes, I'm feeling fairly rugged, thanks, but not at all ambitious. I purposely came back a few days ahead to do some work. I've got a new course to map out, for one thing. But all I've done so far is clean 5 golf clubs. And Mr. Moffat looked with humorous sadness at the bag beside him.
Stuart laughed. Don't you worry, sir. You'll soon be in form again, and making things hard for us as usual.
Mr. Moffat smiled and shook his head. I trust that you are right, but today there's no iron in my makeup. I'm absolutely out of character, and the sorriest theme ever handed in by a junior couldn't move me to wrath.
Well, you've come back to a pretty stiff task, my boy, haven't you?
Do you know, I'm not certain that I wouldn't rather have my own job than yours. If I make mistakes, I can remedy them, or I can gloss them over, but if you make them, they'll stand out on the football season like so many sore thumbs, and you won't have time to remedy them.
A bit awed by the responsibility, are you?
Stuart shook his head smilingly.
No, sir, I don't think so.
Of course, it's going to take some work, but we've got a good crowd to start with. If Mr. Haynes knows football as he's supposed to, things will run along all right, I guess.
The confidence of youth is a beautiful thing, murmured the other.
Well, I sincerely hope that things will run along all right, and I wish you the best luck in the world.
And that means a successful season, crowned by a glorious victory over Pearsall.
I'll be watching with a great deal of interest how the youngest captain ever elected here performs his task, my boy. I hope, though, you won't start out overconfident. I've been here 12 years, and overconfidence at one stage or another of the season has lost more games for us than any other one factor.
Heed the words of age and experience, Harven, and don't write the answer until you've worked out the proposition.
Oh, I'm not cocksure, laughed Stuart. I'm confident that we can win, but I realize that we've got to work every minute and work hard.
By the way, sir, what does amenability mean?
Jack told me that was a quality I didn't have.
Amenability, repeated the instructor.
It means several things.
For one, it means the quality of being open-minded, of willingness to be governed. We speak of a person as being amenable to reason, which usually means that the person has taken our advice, or at least listened to it.
Sounds as though he was calling me pig-headed, said Stuart.
Hardly as bad as that, laughed the other. He was probably trying to convey the idea, and convey it as politely as possible, that you are likely to rely too implicitly on your own judgment and are slightly contemptuous of others.
Isn't that more likely to be it?
Then it means cocksure, grunted Stuart.
I don't think I am.
Do you, sir?
Mr. Moffat smiled, his blue eyes twinkling.
You and I have been pretty good friends for 2 years, Harven, he answered, and we'll probably remain so as long as we don't ask each other questions like that.
Stuart grinned. But seriously, Mr. Moffat, am I like he says?
I don't mean to be.
I'm sure you don't, my boy.
To be frank, there's something in Brewton's indictment, I fancy, but not enough to trouble about.
I'd prefer to call it self-dependence, which, up to a point, is an admirable attribute of youth.
Well, he's always getting off something like that, said Stuart.
I don't mind him.
I wouldn't.
I just make certain that his charge is incorrect, Harven.
Yes, sir.
Then, gosh, I was almost forgetting what I came to see you about.
You know Neil Orr, Mr. Moffat.
He's eligible for a society this year, and I'd like mightily to get him into Lyceum. I'm pretty sure he can make Manning if he wants to, but I'd rather have him with us, and I guess he'd rather too.
Orr is a splendid fellow in my judgment, answered Mr. Moffat, and I'd be glad to have him in Lyceum, but you know, Harven, I'm only the faculty director and have no vote.
Yes, sir, I know that, but I thought you might speak a good word for him when the time comes.
I'm going to put him up, right off.
Gladly, if my opinion is asked, but I can't promise more than that, my boy.
You wouldn't want me to, I'm sure.
No, sir, of course not.
Stuart agreed, but not very fervently. After a moment he added, I think some of the fellows won't want him on account of his being like he is, and I don't think that's fair.
I doubt that, answered the instructor. I can't imagine any of our fellows objecting to Orr on account of physical, disabilities, Harven.
I dislike to think it was so.
Maybe I'm wrong, said Stuart. Only something was said last spring that made me think that way.
Well, I must be off to supper. Jack is probably as mad as a hornet by this time.
Goodbye, sir.
Goodbye, Harven.
Very glad to have seen you again. Drop in some evening before term starts and bring Brewton along, won't you?
Chapter 2, Captain and Coach. Stuart didn't look for Mr. Haynes that evening. Instead, after supper in Safford's only restaurant, he and Jack, together with three other early arrivals, went to the moving picture theater, which, like the old Elm Cafe, was the sole representative of its kind in Safford. Stuart expected to meet the coach the next morning at breakfast, but the latter failed to show up. Pending the opening of Memorial, meals were served to the football players in the Lyceum House. This was a small cottage, situated across the principal's walk at the rear of Holton. In early days it had been used as a dormitory, as had a similar structure in the corner of the new campus. Later, the rooming facilities had been increased by the building of Sawyer and Byers Halls. The two cottages had been given over to the school societies, the Lyceum and Manning. The Lyceum House had four bedrooms on the upper floor and living room, dining room, and kitchen below. This morning, the dining room was crowded when Stuart arrived. 19 fellows had answered the summons to preseason practice, while the table seated but 12. Fortunately, all of them did not come at the same time. As it was, Stuart made the fourth in the waiting line. His appearance was the signal for loud and hearty greetings, and there was much handshaking. Jack Brewton was already there, and promised Stuart his place at table as soon as he got outside a couple more eggs. Most of the returning players on last year's first team were on hand. Burly, red-haired Joe Cutts, the center, Leo Burns, square-headed and sandy-complexioned, as hard-fisted as he was soft-hearted, one of the best halfbacks in recent years, Howdy Tasker, big and gray-eyed and handsome, almost certain of the fullback position, Millard Wheaton, short but sturdy, pink-cheeked and blue-eyed, who meant to give Stuart a hard battle for quarterback supremacy, and others besides. Tom Muirgert, commonly known as Mudguard, yielded his chair to Stuart while Jack was still toying with his second helping of poached eggs, and Stuart deluged his oatmeal with milk and sprinkled it with sugar and pitched in. Whitey, general factotum of the establishment, and as black a darky as ever toiled in a southern cotton field, hurried back and forth in the seemingly hopeless endeavor to supply the wants of the eaters. Oatmeal, bacon, eggs, stewed peaches, toast, coffee, milk disappeared as if by magic, and pathetic plaints filled the air constantly. Oh, Whitey! Got any more bacon? Whitey, bring some more milk, will you?
Coffee, Whitey, and fill her up this time.
Bring me 2-3 eggs, Whitey, and some toast.
Ai, Whitey.
I'm starving.
Get a move on, will you?
At Stuart's left, a pleasant-faced brown-eyed youth asked, Have you seen the coach?
He was asking for you last night.
No, what's he like, Billy?
I thought he'd be here this morning.
Rather a nice sort.
Rather smallish.
Looks keen, though.
Who's that? Asked Joe Cutts from across the board.
Mr. Haynes?
Quite a peppy boy, I'll bet.
He isn't big, but he's got a bad eye, son.
He'll have us jumping for fair.
If he can make you jump, he'll be going some, laughed Billy Littlefield.
Joe smiled tolerantly and landed a piece of toast on Billy's nose.
Wallace Town, slipping into a vacated chair and absent-mindedly annexing Howdy Tasker's glass of milk, joined in with,
I hear there isn't going to be any training table this year.
Where do you get that stuff? Asked Stuart pityingly.
Coach.
He doesn't believe in 'em.
He told me so yesterday.
Came down on the train with him.
Says all we need is plenty of plain food and no coddling.
Told him I didn't care how plain it was, if it was plenty.
Stuart frowned.
That's nonsense, he declared.
We've always had training tables here, and I guess we'll continue to.
All right. You tell him. Whitey, for the love of Mike, feed me. All I've had's a glass of milk.
Yes, and it was mine, observed Howdy.
Feed the brute, Whitey.
Guess the new chap's got a lot of revolutionary ideas, went on Wallace.
Said a mouthful about straight football.
Hates stunt plays, I guess.
Strong on fundamentals, too.
So am I.
We agreed perfectly.
Made a big hit with him.
You would, said Jack scathingly.
You'd agree with anyone, you old sycophant.
What's that? Asked Wallace untroubledly.
An elephant's little boy.
I deny it.
You're thinking of Joe.
I've seen his sort before, said Stuart.
They start out with the idea of changing everything, but they soon get over it.
He smiled patiently.
That straight football guff's mighty old stuff.
It won't win games today.
He'll get over it.
Got any more eggs, Whitey?
Reaching the field at 10:30, a few minutes beyond that time as a matter of fact, but if the captain can't be late, who can? Stuart concluded at first glance that Mr. Haynes had again failed to put in an appearance, and he wasn't altogether displeased. This new coach seemed to be acting rather cocky, Stuart thought, and being late to practice might tone down some of his assurance. But a second look showed a stranger there. The fact that he was in togs, quite as disreputable as any being worn there, had disguised him. He was talking to Miles Whittier, the assistant manager, when Stuart made himself known. Mr. Haynes shook hands cordially, but Stuart thought without as much empressement as the situation called for. While they talked, Stuart studied the other and was conscious of a slight feeling of disappointment. Perhaps the description he had heard was to blame. At all events, the coach was much more of a regular fellow than Stuart had unconsciously pictured him. He was small, perhaps, but the fact didn't impress you greatly because he was remarkably well built. He was younger than Stuart had suspected, too, surely not more than 26. He was good looking, but the good looks were more a matter of expression than of features, for the latter were irregular. There was a short nose and a rather long upper lip, a firm mouth and a square jaw, keen dark brown eyes and a wide forehead under hair that appeared to have a suspicion of red in it. He had a pleasant smile and an agreeable voice, and yet Stuart somehow felt a trifle uncomfortable while they conversed. Perhaps it was the penetrative quality of the straight, unwavering regard of the coach that was responsible. For Alan Haynes was doing a little studying, too. He wanted very much to learn what sort of a youth this was with whom he was to work. What conclusions he reached, I do not know. He saw, however, a straight, well-made boy of a trifle more than normal height and weight for his years, with the good looks of regular features and perfect health. I doubt if he read any antagonism, for I don't think that Stuart was conscious of any, but I think he surmised that behind the blue-gray eyes there lay a touch of arrogance, and perhaps the corners of the pleasantly smiling mouth hinted that its owner was self-willed. Maybe because of such surmises, the coach paid the most respectful deference to Stuart's words, and the latter mentally concluded that Wallace Town's characterization of the new coach had been overdrawn. Probably, he thought, the other had talked sort of big to impress Wallace. There was no harm in that, just so long as he didn't try it on him. "We'd better get together this evening, Harven," the coach was saying, "and talk things over. Suppose I drop in at your room? I haven't found quarters yet, and my room at the hotel is just a box." "Suits me, Mr. Haynes. I'm in Lacey, the second dormitory on the lane, number 12, one flight.
How about 8 o'clock?
"Perfect. Well, shall we get them started?" After practice, the coach had company on the way back to the village. The Laird was taking a dozen or so pairs of football shoes to the repair shop. He had them tied together by the lacings and slung over his shoulder as the coach fell into step beside him. His real name was Angus McCraney, and he looked as Scotch as his name sounded. It was always somewhat of a disappointment, though, to hear the Laird speak, for it was only in moments of excitement that his native burr was used. He had been trainer at Manning for nearly a dozen years, and had become as much a part of the institution as Manning Hall or Old Jarrett,
the Greek and Latin professor, or even Dr. Gurley himself. He was short and leanly muscular, with grizzled hair and pale blue eyes that shone startlingly bright from under thick tufts of brows, and from a seamed face that summer or winter.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.